From the moment we humans first invented the vehicle, we thought to ourselves, but what if it had legs? Oh! Max, baby! Let's be real, we've all wanted to drive a mech suit. Unfortunately for us though, we don't have the GDP of fucking Malawi, so we're gonna have to settle for something cheaper. Video games. Oh, this one? Oh, I missed this one. I'm a bit younger than 30. Oh yeah, no one plays this game and I don't own a VR headset. Oh hey, this one looks cool. How come I've never- oh.
Oh.
Hmm? What? Oh yeah, no, I know about Titanfall. Of course I know about- yeah, you know what? What? Fine. Just for you.
You got it. Stand by for Titanfall.
Holy shit, this game's fucking awesome. But if you're like me, you want something new. Something fresh. I mean, Titanfall's fucking awesome, but you want something more. But what if I told you there was another mech game? A mech game that made you feel like you were in a powerful machine of war. Not through audio, visuals, or anything else, but through the power of your imagination. A tabletop RPG. Called Lancer! What the fuck do you think you're doing? Before you play Lancer, you gotta know the lore, baby. And there's a lot of it. Okay, fuck. Okay, listen. The following is grossly oversimplified. Do not get mad at me. I'm just trying to give enough context. Okay, let's go. So, it's the far future. You know how it is. Humans destroy the Earth. Fucking twice. The second time around, humans decide communism is the way to go, and form Union. Union is the new intergalactic government. Humans expand to the stars, but sublight travel is slow as shit, so the first travelers had to go into stasis for so long that we actually invented faster than light travel before they made it to their destinations. How did we do this? Well, back in the solar system, on a Martian moon, Deimos, a bunch of AIs accidentally create a god called Ra, and Deimos just gets fucking teleported away. And reality is permanently warped by this. This massive reality-bending event is felt throughout the whole galaxy. Good news is that we figure out how to use faster-than-light travel because of this, because, you know, space-time folding and whatnot. Bad news is, random AIs around the galaxy just started turning into digital demigods, beings with infinite potential called Deimos entities. They caused untold havoc until we slapped them, gave them some drugs, and put them in a box, copy and pasted them into our own machines. Now we have our very own super AI assistants called non-human persons, or NHPs. Ignoring the fact that they could break free at any moment, they're actually pretty useful. Okay, with our new blink space travel, we find a new planet with sentient life called Hercynia. Hercynia is a beautiful planet with lush trees and ginormous foliage and wildlife. The sentient dominant species on this planet is a species of psychic insectoids called the Egregorians. I want you to take a wild guess on what we humans did. Because the planet is covered in trees and roots, no traditional vehicles could traverse its surface. So, we gave our cars legs and a flamethrower. Boom! The first mechanized chassis was born. Meet Genghis Mach 1, the world killer. That's his name. Our primal instinct to destroy everything in our path kicked in, and we created mechs. We figured that mechs just work so damn well that we just started using them for everything. And thus, Lancers were born. That's you! You're a Lancer. You're a mech pilot that's so good at your job, they invented a new word for you. As a Lancer, your mech is custom designed and tailored to perfectly suit you. You are a part of your mech as much as it is a part of you. A mystical bond between human and machine. For better or for worse. Okay, so now that we have some much-needed context, we can slow stuff down for a bit and focus a little more on the more important stuff. So, in the world of Lancer, union rules most of the galaxy. And this post-scarcity communist rule means that, as a Lancer, you get all your equipment for free from union, limited only by your Lancer license level. The higher your level, the better equipment you get. While we're on the topic of Union, let's discuss the equipment they can provide you with through their engineering division, General Massive Systems, or GMS. GMS quite literally sets the galactic standard for equipment and technology. If it's worse than GMS, it is bad. So it's no surprise that the mech they provide you with is Everest, and is also considered to be the baseline for all mechs. If it's worse than Everest, it is bad. Everest is arguably one of the best mechs in the game because, well, it's so balanced. No matter what weapon or build you run on it, it will get the job done. And it is the first mech that you get when you play Lancer at license level 0. You might notice that there is no official artwork for Everest. This is because Everest is so customizable. And also because this is your mech. You get to draw your mech however you like, or you get to steal any art off of Pinterest. Look, so far I've been oversimplifying. Union used to be a lot worse than it is now. The artwork I've been using isn't even accurate. Union worlds look more like this. At least the core worlds do, where Union's at its strongest. Union's utopian pillars are 1. All shall have their material needs fulfilled. 2. No wall shall stand between worlds. And 3. No human shall be held in bondage through force, labor, or debt. And if you're wondering why we Lancers look like this, it's because most of the fighting is happening on the outer worlds. For being an intergalactic government, Union is pretty good at its job. Now, to clarify, Union is not the only manufacturer. There are 5 main manufacturers in the world of Lancer, Union being one of them. We're going to cover all of them, because- Okay, whatever, it doesn't matter. Hello, future Dylan here. So you know how Lancer has, like, supplement books that add new stuff, like new mechs and new stories and whatnot? I originally thought you had to buy them to get the new mechs. But Massive Press is so fucking base, they actually allow you to get the mechs for free! You just need to buy the books if you want to play the story. So, because I hate myself, I'm covering all the DLCs! So whenever you see this logo at the top left of the screen, you know that it is part of the free DLCs that you can get. The 2 mechs that you can get at license level 0, because they're GMS mechs, is Sagarmatha and Komolungma. Mechs that are similar to Everest, wherein they are very customizable and balanced, but being more focused on tank-like gameplay and hacking gameplay, respectively. I also added the names of the DLCs that they are from. Also, when you see size, that means that's their size class. Yes, there are different size classes. Alright, onto the manufacturers. Welcome to Interplanetary Shipping Northstar, a shipping company turned manufacturer. IPSN is responsible for a majority of space travel and shipping lanes, and thus have access to all the goods that come through it. Their mechs and equipment are reliable and trustworthy. The same can be said for the people that work for the company. IPSN aims to provide tried and true gear, built tough, built to last. IPSN is the oldest of the manufacturers. It started out as a naval shipping company on Earth, and now resides on the water planet of Carina, where the headquarters are. On brand for the company, all their mechs are named after famous naval figures. IPSN provides us with mechs such as Blackbeard, a lightweight, fragile but deadly melee killing machine with grappling hooks and chain axes. Drake, a sturdy, tanky brick shithouse with big guns and even bigger shields. Stand behind this guy if you need cover. Lancaster, a speedy repair station on legs. Low offense, but massive support capabilities. Support drones, repair kits, Lancaster's got it all. Nelson, a fast skirmisher. Hit enemies, never get hit. Control the battlefield with superior tactics and fighting.
Raleigh, a gunslinger mech with a fucking chest revolver cannon. Need I say more? Tortuga, the watchful eye. If you play D&D with Sentinel and opportunity attacks, this is your guy. Vlad, the Impaler. Enemies try to attack you? Enemies attack your teammates? Enemies dare exist within your vicinity? DLC time! Caliban. This scary motherfucker counts as size 3s when he knocks people down. Kid. As if the pirate analogy for IPSN wasn't obvious enough. Stortebecker. Okay, who the fuck let their DeviantArt OC in here? Zeng. Take a wild guess what he does. No matter where you are in the galaxy, remember, you can always look to the North Star for guidance. Elegance. Power. Few can strike a balance between both. Out of all the Corpro states, none are as eloquent and top of the line as Smith Shimano Corpro. The question is not, can you afford their products? The question is, can you handle them? SSC is the Gucci and Balenciaga of Lancer, except that SSC is actually practical. They specialize in luxury products, bionic parts, travel, combat, all done in style with SSC. The members of the company worked hard to get there. Only the best of the best make it in SSC. SSC has earned to be pretentious. They named all their mechs after mods. Black Witch, the Queen of Magnetism. Control the battlefield with mag parries and magnetic fields. Anything metal belongs to her. Death's Head, the sniper frame. Perfect for long-range engagements. Mark enemies for death to deal more damage. Duskwing, the exoskeleton flight suit. Fly around, create mirror images, and cloak. One of the smallest mechs and one of the hardest to hit. Metal Mark, cutting-edge technology. Equipped with Tactical Cloak, one of the most dangerous mechs in Lancer. Monarch.
Fucking stand still, you piece of, you know, fucking.
Justice reigns from above!
Yeah, good fucking luck dodging this one. Morning Cloak. Equipped with experimental blink space technology. This mech can. Also, the teleport has a chance to just fuck up and the mech can just disappear for the whole fight. I think that's funny. Swallowtail. Equipped with an advanced AI that predicts every next move. Whoop-whoop-whoop, DLC time! Atlas, the giant killer. Okay, get your Metal Gear jokes out now. Emperor. He has lightning powers. Where have I heard that one before? Orcus. He has a big shield, so... Viceroy. She's the same as Monarch, but oh my god, she's so hot. Swallowtail, Ranger variant. This is just a fucked up Swallowtail. White Witch. Oh my god, she's so fucking strong. Why is she- If you want to make your way through the galaxy in style, Smith Shimano Corpro's got you covered. You know, I think I need a break. Things are getting too normal around here.
Let's get weird.
Hey, so remember when I said
a bunch of AIs accidentally create a god called Ra, and Deimos just gets fucking teleported away?
So because of this, not only faster than light travel is a thing now, faster than light internet is too. People from across the galaxy can communicate instantly with the Omninet. And in the depths and the cracks of the Omninet lies Horus. Horus specializes in paracausal and anomalous tech. All of it breaks the known laws of reality. Horus is not a company, it's a collective of users spread across the galaxy.
Or at least that's what we think.
Because not only is Horus so hard to track, their tech just appears out of nowhere. Seriously, you can just either find Horus tech in the wild, or you complete a complex internet ARG and your prize is a goddamn mech blueprint. And of course these nerds named their mechs after fantasy monsters. Baylor.
Nanomachine, son!
Shred anything in your way with nanomachine fire. Goblin. This mech is the most powerful hacker in.
Saludos. Soy yo, el goblino. Los piratas informáticos como yo pueden acceder fácilmente a su información privada. Por eso deberías usar
Gorgon. Like the fantasy Gorgon, this mech stuns you. How does it do this? Symptoms include encephalitis, hemorrhaging, paralysis, corporeal...
Manticore!
Castigate the enemies of the god!
Minotaur. Because of anomalous tech, this mech takes up more space than it actually occupies, which makes it almost on par with your mother. Hydra. Cut down one head, two more take its place. Oh, wait, that's three. That's no. Four. Every part of him is a drone. Holy sh- Pegasus. Okay, so this is the Ushabti Omnigun. Funny thing is, see, right now, this weapon technically doesn't even exist. You're shooting them with a gun that isn't real. And yet it is. Don't worry, Ra's like that. Just here, know that because it exists at some point, we've made it. And that's causality, and causality is a fu- Don't worry, it gets worse. Calendula literally sends you to the Shadow Realm. Kobold. He's just a little guy, he's a little dude, he dig.
Lich. No tagline, just Lich. They call me Undying, but I haven't died yet. And I've already died. I know it's difficult to understand, my child. Come with me. I'll help you understand. It's time to drink deep and descend.
Vete a la mierda, viejo.
Horus is unpredictable, but they're not malicious or evil. So, play nice with them, and they might help you out every now and then.
Have you ever been so disgusted by the genocide of a sentient species that you decide to flee the government and make your own company from a bunch of mining communes and decide to clone yourself and raise your clone self as a son and as the heir of the company? That's what it feels like to be the CEO of Harrison Armory.
Harrison Armory is the youngest of all the manufacturers, only popping up after the Hersinia tragedy. Don't let that fool you, though. Landing on the geological gold mine that is Rash Shamra, a mining planet with a single habitable band and in permanent tidal lock, and using NHPs to develop new technologies, and having a strong trade bond with Union, put HA as one of the top manufacturers in the galaxy. Harrison Armory members are diligent and hard workers. They work day and night to ensure top quality and performance from their mechs. Their mechs are named after warlords because it's fitting because they commit war crimes. Sherman, the second most common mech in the galaxy next to Everest. Top quality design. And also a big fuck off laser. Genghis Mach 2, the foliage removal mech.
You not like the full taste of
war crimes?
Try diet.
War crimes. It's war crimes.
Without the guilt of being a
war criminal.
Iskander specializes in
bombs. You want it? It's yours, my friend. As long as you have enough
bombs.
Saladin, the selfless protector.
He's my best friend. He's my pal. He's my homeboy. My rotten soldier. He's my sweet cheese. My good time boy.
Napoleon. Napoleon can surround itself in void energy to stop any damage from coming in or going out. Also, it has been a billion years and Napoleon still can't escape the short jokes. Tokugawa. The hotter this mech's reactor runs, the more damage he does. So to maintain a constant damage output, he has to stay in the danger zone. Barbarossa.
Oh yeah. Damn, boy! Damn, boy, he's thick! Boy, that's a thick-ass boy! Damn! Bah!
Final round of DLC characters. Sunzi, for the love of God, please stand still!
I don't want to set the world on fire.
Enkidu. We used this guy in the Hersinia tragedy as well. And just when you thought we gave those bugs a chance. Powerful is an understatement when describing Harrison Armory's technology. But hey, if you need some war criminals on your side, Harrison Armory's got you covered. Alright, let's teach you how to play, shall we? First thing you want to do is you get CompCon. That's comp/con. It's an online digital companion, like D&D Beyond, but better because it's free. From here, you're gonna create your Lancer. First of all, go to the pilot roster and create a new pilot. And then think of a pilot. If you didn't figure out already, this will be your character. Lancers come in all shapes and sizes. But for this demonstration, we're going to create a funky little dude called John Electric, a black market engineer. People call him Sparky.
Pleasure doing business with ya.
ComCon also has some pre-made backgrounds, one of which being engineer. Now, backgrounds don't give any mechanical advantages, but they do give you a clearer idea of what your character would be doing in the world of Lancer, given their job. After that, we choose skills. Now, skills are grouped into triggers, which are different scenarios where your skills will be useful. Things such as apply fists to face, survive, stay cool, act unseen, hack or fix, so on and so forth. Basic things that your character will be doing outside of the mech. John is a bit of a nut job, so for his skill triggers, we'll choose blow something up, hack or fix, invent or create, and word on the street. Whenever John is doing something outside of his mech suit that relates to any of these four things, he can do them much better than anyone else. Next, we'll choose pilot talents, things that your pilot is so good at that it affects the way they pilot their mech. There are a ton of different talents to choose from. Stuff like Ace that allows you to fly better in your mech, Brawler that allows you to grapple and wrestle in the mech, Brutal which allows you to do more damage on critical hits, so on and so forth. These talents can also be upgraded to give even stronger abilities to your mech. John's talents will be Crackshot that makes him a better sniper, Engineer that gives him access to experimental weaponry that he built himself, and Grease Monkey, a talent that allows him to repair his mech for less cost and materials because he's so good at it. Then, onto the mech skills. Four stats that dictate the four different aspects of driving a mech and how good your pilot is at it. Because John is an engineer, we're going to be putting both of our skill points in engineering. There we go, there's your pilot. Last thing you can go check out is the pilot gear, which is stuff like what type of armor they use, what type of weapon they use, what type of gear they have on them. But for the sake of simplicity, we're going to be skipping that because it's only based on what missions you want to do. They're interchangeable and stuff. Without further ado, let's make your mech. Now, there are tons of mechs in Lancer. They're called frames because they, while having a base model and having different abilities, they're heavily customizable. None more customizable than Everest, the mech that you'll be getting at license level 0 when you start playing. So let's begin. First of all, equipment. Because John is an engineer, he can install the prototype weapon onto his mech. John built this weapon for his mech from scratch, so he may choose whether it is a ranged or melee, or what type of damage it does. Now for a main weapon. Weapons go into different mounts of your mech. Everest has one main mount, one flex mount, and one heavy mount. There are many different weapon options that give many different advantages. Shotguns are good for close range, mortars are good for long range, sniper rifles, melee weapons, etc. In the main mount, we will be equipping an assault rifle. Flex mounts can take one main weapon or two auxiliary weapons. Auxiliary weapons are just weapons that are lighter. So, we'll be equipping two missile racks, because, you know, we can never have enough missiles. Next up, heavy mounts. Heavy mounts are used for the heaviest of weapons. For example, a heavy melee weapon. And last but not least, systems. You use system points to buy systems, which can help you do various different things and customize your mech even further. Things such as EVA modules, flight systems, deployable cover, etc. For our mech, we will be choosing Pattern A smoke charges. Smoke bombs, if you will. Next, stable structure. No one's knocking you down anytime soon. And to finish off, a custom paint job and an expanded compartment. And with that, I'd like you to meet Sparkplug.
All systems online, ready to solve some problems.
Please enjoy this example scenario that I have set up to teach you how to play Lancer. If you played tabletop RPGs like D&D, some of the mechanics might be familiar to you. First thing you'll notice is that Lancer is played on a hex map. Now, you can play Lancer on a square map, it's entirely your choice, but hex maps have the benefit of being equal no matter where you point. where a square map will be kind of longer if you go diagonally and measurements get weird. Here, every direction is equal. And also, hexagons are the most futuristic shape. Because of future technology and 3D printers, Lancers have the option to customize their mech in any way they want before a mission. Let's drop in our Lancers, shall we? Now, you've already met Sparky and his mech Sparkplug. But for this demonstration, we will also add Hamlet and her Komalungma Snowcrash, a hacking-focused mech. Their objective is to make it past the three mercenaries and acquire that W, a half-sized item that they need to retrieve and bring back to where they came from. Alright, let's begin combat. First things first, players always go first, no matter what happens. The players may choose among themselves who of them will go first. In this case, Sparky elects to go first. Sparkplug has a speed of 4, so he may move 4 spaces in his movement. Sparky moves here to try and get a shot on that sniper. This sniper is 2 spaces above him and hiding behind the ledge of the cliff. Different DMs might rule this in different ways, but I would rule this that the sniper has soft cover. I've taken the liberty of making a cheat sheet to help better explain what this means. In Lancer, there is a mechanic called accuracy and difficulty, where you roll a 1d6 and add or subtract it from your d20 roll. You have +1 difficulty when trying to hit someone behind soft cover. During each turn, you may take 1 full action or 2 quick actions. Attacking one enemy with one weapon is a quick action and is called skirmish. You cannot repeat identical quick actions and you cannot fire twice from the same weapon in one turn. This is why the barrage full action exists. It allows you to attack with 2 weapons on 1 or 2 targets. Sparky decides to fire his assault rifle and his missile rack at the sniper. If you are firing a weapon in a given mount, in this case the missile rack, and there is an additional auxiliary weapon in the same mount, in this case the other missile rack, you may fire that auxiliary weapon with your main weapon as well, although the additional auxiliary weapon does not get bonus damage. So Sparky is going to fire both missile racks. Sparky checks to see if the sniper is within range of his assault rifle. The assault rifle has a range of 10 spaces. It is. Sparky has to roll a d20, -1d6, and try and meet or beat the sniper's evasion. Right now, Sparky does not know what the sniper's evasion is. Sparky rolls a 17 and a 4. That makes a total of 13. Sparky hits with his assault rifle. Now he gets to roll for damage. Sparky rolls a 1. Fuck. Sparky's in luck though, because his assault rifle has the reliable trait. In this case, reliable tier 2. This means that even if Sparky misses or rolls less damage, the assault rifle will always do 2 damage, minimum. It's settled, the sniper takes 2 kinetic damage, but Sparky's not done yet. Sparky rolls 2 more attacks to see if he hits with the missile racks. 1 hits, 1 misses. The sniper takes an additional 4 blast damage from the missiles. Now at this point, I would say something akin to the line of, the sniper is looking quite damaged. The players are not allowed to know the sniper's exact HP without scanning the sniper first, but, you know, if a sniper falls below half or a quarter health, it's clear to see that the mech is not doing well. Sparky really wants to finish off the sniper, so he checks to see what else he can do during his turn. Sparky has already made a full action this turn, and since he has a speed of 4 but only moved 3 spaces, he has 1 movement left. He also has overcharge. Overcharging is when you push your mech to its limits, empowering the mech for a short while, but at a cost of straining the systems of the mech itself. Overcharging allows you to take 1 extra quick action at the cost of taking heat. You can overcharge once per turn and any amount of times in a combat, but if you do it a lot, your mech is not gonna like it. Between every full repair, the first overcharge will give you only 1 heat, second will give you 1d3, and the third and onward will give you 1d6 plus 4. Think of heat as a secondary health bar. For your HP, when you take enough damage to drop you to 0 hit points, your mech does not die immediately. Instead, once you reach 0 HP, your mech will take 1 structure damage, and your HP will reset back to full. However, when this happens, you have to roll on the structure damage table. There are always consequences to losing a full bar of HP. You roll an amount of d6 equal to the amount of structure damage you've taken. Then you take the lowest roll and see what happened. A 5 or a 6, you're fine. Your mech is just impaired until the end of your next turn. 2 or a 4, not as fine. A system or a weapon just got blasted off your mech. Once you roll to see if you lose a system or a weapon, you get to choose which weapon or system you lose. A 1 is bad. Depending on how much structure you have left, you'll either be stunned or destroyed outright. 2 ones is immediate destruction. Heat works exactly the same way. Instead, it ticks up instead of ticking down. And this time, you take stress damage when you go over your heat cap. The heat that took you over your heat cap stays in your heat bar. And like HP, you roll this time on the stress damage table. Works exactly the same way, just different effects. Sparky decides to overcharge and only takes 1 heat. With his extra quick action, Sparky decides to use the skirmish action. Sparky decides to attack with his prototype weapon. This is a weapon unique to Sparky because Sparky chose the engineer pilot talent. The last time Sparky performed a full repair on his mech, he got to choose the traits of the prototype weapon. He chose that it would be a range weapon, which gives it a range of 10, and that the damage type will be burn damage. Burn damage is special in the sense that, for example, let's say you take 2 burn damage. You will still continue to burn. You now have a burn count of 2. At the end of your turn, you make an engineering check to see if you clear the burn. If you fail the check, you take the amount of damage of your burn count. And if it wasn't bad enough, burn also ignores armor. And burn damage stacks. At the end of every turn, you get to retry the engineering check. And if you pass, you clear all your burn. You can also clear your burn by using the stabilize action. Sparky fires his prototype weapon and does enough damage to completely destroy the sniper. It is now the big guy's turn. The big guy uses the lock-on quick tech action. This action requires no roll. The target just needs to be within sensor range and line of sight. The big guy now has a lock-on on Sparky. The big guy, or his teammate, could consume the lock-on on his turn. But Big Guy decides to consume his own lock-on to give himself +1 accuracy to his next attack. Considering Sparky is only partly within line of sight, Sparky will benefit from hard cover from the rock he's standing behind. Hard cover gives +2 difficulty to any attackers, but since he consumed a lock-on that gives him +1 accuracy, the accuracy and difficulty cancels out and it'll only end up being +1 difficulty for the Big Guy. The big guy shoots his rotary cannon, hits, and deals 4 blast damage. This is when Sparky decides to use his reaction. In this case, the brace reaction. Reactions can only be used once per round and can be used when a trigger effect happens. In this case, the trigger effect is Sparky taking damage. Sparky has resistance to the incoming damage and only takes half damage, which is 2 blast instead of 4. And lastly, big guy decides to use a protocol. Protocols are free actions. You may take any amount of free actions in a turn as you wish, as long as it is different free actions. Big Guy and his teammate now has resistance to all damage coming from Sparky. It is now Hamlet's turn. Hamlet sees that this is going nowhere fast and decides to get some info on the enemies. Hamlet uses the scanned quick tech action. This action requires no roll and can give you a bunch of different options for information gathering. For example, you can choose to know a mech's exact stats, HP, speed, evasion, etc., but you can also use it for role-playing purposes, like scanning for secret information, like confidential cargo, current mission, or identifying the pilot, and so on. This also includes general or public information, like bank records or model numbers of mechs. This demonstration is supposed to show that at the end of the day, Lancer is still a tabletop role-playing game. Just like D&D, it can be used to tell stories. Since scan does not require line of sight, and the assault mercenary is within sensor range, Hamlet decides to just scan the mercenary from here. She decides to scan for pilot identification. It's someone she recognizes. Knowing that she can end the fight now, she flies up to this ridge using her flight system, and decides to use her second quick action as the invade quick tech action. Invade allows you to get into a target's systems, depending on what invade action you want to take, but Hamlet wants to use it to hack into the mercenary's comm systems. Now, this isn't what it's usually used for, but I, as a DM, think this is rad as fuck and will allow it. All Hamlet needs to do now is to hit this tech attack. The mechanics are exactly the same as a normal attack, except for this one, you don't add your grit, you add your tech attack bonus. And instead of targeting evasion, tech attacks have to meet or beat an enemy's e-defense. The hack is successful, and Hamlet is now connected to the mercenary's comlinks.
Oi, stop shooting, cunt, it's me.
Wait, Mary?
But how the fuck did you even get into our comm systems?
Wait, your fucking name's Mary?
Shut the fuck up, Sparky.
Boss, what is happening? You know these goons?
Yeah, I know one of them, because one of them's my piece of shit sister.
Love you too, James.
Yeah, sure, that's all well and good, but they still kind of, you know, killed Larry, our sniper.
Oh yeah, that. Well, Larry was kind of an arsehole anyways.
Well, looks like that's settled then. Who knew a fight could be resolved with some family reunion? Quite a shocker.
Shut your fucking mouth, Sparky!
Hey yo, if you made it this far, congratulations, you just made it through 35 plus minutes of my ADHD-induced rambling about the nerdiest hobby in existence. I fucking commend you. That is something that not even I can make it through. I still don't know how to exactly put a neat bow over these kind of videos and close them off, but all I can say is go check Lancer out. Go to CompCon, or go check out YouTube videos like 11 Dragon Kid videos. He makes fucking amazing videos. Probably put his YouTube channel in the comments or whatever. But yeah, Lancer got me hooked immediately the moment I found it, and hopefully this video has done the same for you. Or if it hasn't, at least it'll put Lancer on the radar for you, and then you can go find out more about Lancer yourself. And for those of you who I specifically sent this video to, because I'm most certainly sending it to some of you, yay. I don't fucking know, man. I'm a big nerd who likes big robots and tabletop RPGs. I hope you do too. See ya, I guess.